ETF Prime is hosted by investment advisors at the ETF Store and sponsored by Legg Mason. Legg Mason's sponsorship is not an endorsement nor a recommendation for any product or service. Legg Mason Investor Services LLC is not affiliated with the ETF Store, ETF.com, or any of its affiliates. The ETF Store is not affiliated with ETF.com or any of its affiliates. ETF.com's participation in this program should not be construed as an endorsement or an indication by ETF.com of the value of any ETF Store product or service. This program is for informational purposes only and does not constitute investment advice. All investing involves risk, including the potential loss of principal. Past performance is no guarantee of future results. The ETF Store owns and is responsible for all program content. Visit ETFstore.com for more information.
Legg Mason is a leading global investment company committed to helping clients reach their financial goals through long-term actively managed strategies. Legg Mason offers a broad range of equity, fixed income, alternative, and cash strategies worldwide. It is comprised of a diverse family of specialized investment managers, each with their own independent approach to research and analysis, and has over a century of experience in identifying opportunities and delivering astute investment solutions to clients. To learn more, please visit LeggMason.com.
Now it's time for ETF Prime, where we discuss everything you need to know about exchange-traded funds and the world of investing. Whether you're an investing expert or just starting out, Nate and Jason will help you get up to date on what's happening on Wall Street and show you how exchange-traded funds can help lower your investment costs, reduce your tax bill, and allow you to take advantage of investment opportunities around the world. And now, the host of ETF Prime, Nate Geraci.
All right, great show today. As always, I want to thank the exclusive sponsor of ETF Prime, Legg Mason. A big story in the markets this year is the number of high-profile initial public offerings, IPOs, new publicly traded stocks coming to market. We just saw the Lyft IPO a couple of weeks ago, Levi Strauss earlier this year. And listen to some of these companies on deck. Uber, Pinterest, Zoom, and then some of the other names that could IPO this year include Airbnb, Slack, Robinhood, Peloton. 2019 has actually been called the year of the unicorn IPO. In just a moment, we'll be joined by ETF.com's Dave Noddick to take a look at some ETFs offering exposure to companies who have recently IPO'd. Because, Jason, look, your standard S&P 500 index fund isn't going to hold these companies right away. So if you want to own a company like Lyft in an ETF, you're going to have to look at ETFs specifically focused on IPOs or else look to some actively managed ETFs.
These are some amazing names, and everybody knows about them. Uber, Airbnb, you know, Peloton. What a concept. You get on a bike. When I ride a bike, I want to go somewhere, but a lot of people are comfortable just spinning the wheel. There's so much excitement at this stage. Who doesn't want to own growth, right? That's where we want to be. I think the challenge is, how do you get exposure to these names early on in the growth cycle? You know, obviously, you can buy the individual security. You've got the concentration risk and some other issues. And I think where we're going to go with this is that many of the broad-based ETFs don't necessarily pick up these names early on. You need to wait for a rebalance situation. Perhaps security needs to meet some other criteria. And so for investors in the larger broad-based ETFs, you're not necessarily going to get this exposure early on. Hopefully Dave will help us sort this out.
Yeah, and also I think we should mention, yes, there is a lot of growth and excitement around IPOs, but I'm not sure these are always set up for mom and pop investor to be successful. So hopefully we'll touch on that with Dave as well. Later in the show, we'll be joined by Phil Huber, Chief Investment Officer at Huber Financial Advisors. Phil also blogs at bipsandpieces.com. I actually met Phil down at the Inside ETFs conference, and we got to talking about his firm's use of ETFs. I thought it'd be interesting just to learn more about their process. Huber Financial manages nearly $1.5 billion in assets. So we're going to talk about how they go about selecting ETFs for their portfolios. And then we'll also have a little fun. We're going to put Phil through our ETF gauntlet today, our rapid fire Q&A. We have some great questions lined up for Phil. Then to close the show today, Alex Petty, president and head of ETFs for Hoya Capital Real Estate, will spotlight the recently launched Hoya Capital Housing ETF, which is unique because it doesn't just own REITs or home builders or home improvement companies. Instead, it combines all of them. And this also holds technology companies operating in the real estate space, companies like Zillow. So we'll find out why Alex launched this ETF and what the investment case is. As always, if you have questions or comments, you can visit etfprime.com or you can find me on Twitter at Nate Geraci. Also, if you enjoy ETF Prime, we would greatly appreciate if you could leave us a quick review on iTunes. All right, let's start today with ETF.com's Dave Nodig.
Time now for our weekly chat with the experts at ETF.com, the world's leading independent authority on ETFs.
People have been saying there are too many mutual funds since the 80s.
For all the talk of smart beta, they haven't pulled in huge assets.
The active managers are showing up in the ETF space.
So Dave, as Jason and I were just mentioning, one of the nuances of index-based ETFs that track something like the S&P 500 is they have rules in place on when they can add new companies like Lyft or Uber, which will IPO here in the near future. And we can certainly debate whether that's a good or bad thing. But before we talk ETFs specifically focused on IPOs, can you just describe the process for how many of the larger, more popular broad-based indexes handle initial public offerings? Because I don't think some people realize it could be a while before they add companies like Lyft or Uber.
Yeah, most big index providers have some sort of aging requirement. That's actually what it's called. And if you think about it, it makes a certain amount of sense. Like, no matter how big a new company is in the space, you know, even if it were, you know, debuted at multi-billion dollar, $20 billion valuation, which would firmly place it in, I don't know, say an S&P tech index or something like that, you know, from the S&P's perspective or from MSCI's perspective, they want to make sure that these companies are viable not only as companies but as trading entities. And as we all know, having watched a lot of IPOs over decades, sometimes you get, let's just call it shenanigans around the actual launch of an IPO. We get sort of obvious mispricings where things come in and trade, you know, at $100, but their quote unquote, you know, offering price is 50. And then there's a lot of volatility. So for years, decades, most of these index providers have had an aging requirement, which ranges from something like 3 to 6 months. And that's a pretty normal gate for these things. That has actually come way in. You're starting to see a lot of index providers put the ability for an index committee or review process around particularly large IPOs. We saw some of those rule changes come in when Alibaba IPO'd in the U.S., and a lot of people were, you know, hankering to get that into the indexes. But for the most part, that sort of three-month window is still, I think, the industry standard.
Okay, so for investors who do want immediate exposure to newly public companies in an ETF wrapper, there are really two targeted options that exist right now covering the U.S. market. You have the First Trust U.S. Equity Opportunities ETF, ticker FPX. That's the most popular ETF by assets. And then there's also the Renaissance IPO ETF, great ticker symbol, IPO. Maybe first walk us through what each of these does, and then we can, I guess, further compare and contrast here.
Sure. I mean, they're both focused on the U.S. IPO market, you know, new companies trading on U.S. markets. So from that perspective, they're very similar. They both have sort of fast-tracked ability to get an IPO in as early as 4 or 5 days, I think 6 days for the IPO fund, I think maybe 5 days for FPX, but functionally the same. They don't buy, I think it's important to recognize, they don't buy on the offering. So they're not participating, you know, in the red herring process and getting allocated pre-market shares. I think that's a mistake some investors make when they think about this. They think these funds are somehow giving them that aha moment of day one bubbles that, you know, I think traders, you know, retire on if they get it exactly right. They're not doing that. They're waiting until these have been in the market for a few days for prices to settle down, and then they buy new IPOs. The big difference is frankly in how long they hold and what they do on takeovers. So FPX, which is the big fund, it's roughly $1 billion, it will hold for up to 4 years and occasionally longer. And importantly, if an IPO that they've been holding, say, for the last 2 years, gets bought by Eli Lilly or something like that, then Eli Lilly ends up in the portfolio. So you end up with this bizarre situation where if you look at the top 10 holdings of FPX, none of them look like IPOs. They're all S&P 500 names. They're huge companies that have been trading forever because it's somewhere along the line they bought a pharmaceutical company, they bought a small tech company. And further, because they're holding for 4 years, the likelihood that you're going to continue to see those kinds of sort of takeover inclusions, I think is still very high. A lot of small companies do get acquired a few years after their IPO. The Renaissance IPO fund, because it sort of kicks things out at 2 years, it tends to be a more concentrated portfolio. It tends to be a more pure play on what's actually going on in the IPO market.
We mentioned the recent Lyft IPO. Do both of these now own Lyft stock?
They do, but they own them in very different amounts for precisely the reasons I was just talking about, because FPX's portfolio is bigger, and it includes some just huge mega caps almost sort of by accident. I mean, it is by design, but it's certainly not what investors expect. I believe the Lyft allocation in FPX is about 0.5%, something like that, maybe even less, and it's over 1% in IPO because it takes up a bigger part of a smaller portfolio. What you won't see in there necessarily are some other recent IPOs. For instance, I didn't see Tradeweb in either portfolio this morning when I checked. I haven't seen Levi in there. And my suspicion there is they both have rules around particular stocks that have excessive one-day bumps that can kick them into another aging process, again, to try to avoid putting investors into extremely volatile stocks. And then for smaller IPOs, even the IPO fund from Renaissance will wait until a quarterly rebalance to include a small IPO.
What about actively managed ETFs? I actually used ETF.com's very handy stock screener tool, and I was a bit surprised to see the RYZZ Managed Future Strategy Plus ETF owning some Lyft stock. But I guess that's another place where IPOs could be added, right? Actively managed ETFs.
Absolutely. And we actually have a few sort of high-profile actively managed funds, particularly the ones from ARK Invest, being run by Kathy Wood, ARKK, ARKW. Those are quite intentionally highly traded, high-conviction portfolios. Kathy Wood has notably been a very strong proponent of Tesla, has even had Elon Musk on her podcast. And I would not be surprised to see ARK or a firm like that pick up some of these IPOs early. They don't have any restrictions on them other than their own sort of investment call.
What's your take on investing in IPOs altogether, whether through an ETF or individually? And I actually saw some data over the weekend from University of Florida professor Jay Ritter. He does a lot of analysis in this area, and he had a stat that greater than 60% of the 7,000-plus IPOs from 1975 to 2011 had negative absolute returns 5 years following their first day of trading. And you look at something like Lyft, that's already down fairly substantially from its IPO price. So how do you think investors should approach the IPO space?
Well, back when I used to be, a bit of a confession, I used to be an active equity fund manager myself, and I loved getting allocations from my broker-dealers, because back then during the dot-com boom, the game was always, it would be priced at 20 and trade at 80, and so it was a way to sort of book a quick early profit. That's largely changed. By the time most investors will get access to an IPO, it's fully priced. There's no sort of magic underpricing that you're going to pick up. So what you're buying then when you go and just buy shares of Lyft today in the market is you are buying shares in the most speculative of companies. Nearly by definition, a company is IPOing when it has just enough of a business to look credible but could really use the money by selling a whole bunch of shares in the open market to fund generally some sort of really aggressive growth plan, an acquisition spree, something like that. Those are risky things. So you should think about IPOs as being, in a sense, the riskiest part of the equity markets, except for maybe special situations and companies that are about to go bankrupt on the other end of the capital market.
Well, on that note, so going back to the IPO ETFs, where do you see these fitting in a portfolio? And obviously the benefit is you get diversified exposure to IPOs, which you just mentioned could be risky. But you see these ETFs as satellite holdings or something more?
No, they're definitely satellite holdings. The way I think about these is, we all know many folks that have very rational portfolios, but then over in the corner they have 10% of their money that they quote-unquote play with. Not a phrase I like to use, but they enjoy the process of trading stocks. They enjoy the process of being in the investment management industry, if you will, from an individual perspective. And there's nothing wrong with that. In fact, I think for a lot of investors, it keeps their mind focused on the markets in a positive way, and they're less likely to do something dumb, and sell all their money when the market's down 5%. That's my hope, at least. But that's where you should think, I think, about these IPO ETFs. They are speculations. They are a little more diversified than just going out and buying Lyft stock, obviously, but you should put it in the same mental bucket.
All right, lastly, I know you're not in the business of making market calls or predictions, but I mentioned at the top of the show the substantial number of high-profile companies coming to market, right? This has been called the year of the unicorn IPO. Do you think the hot IPO market tells us anything at all about the stock market overall, that perhaps it's a bit frothy?
Certainly firms don't generally time their IPOs when they feel like the markets are terrible. So from that perspective, you can read into the fact that we've got, Zoom and HSCU and all these firms coming out and all these ones that have already come out this year as an indication that at least investment bankers believe the markets are hot right now. Now, whether that means they're too hot or not obviously remains to be seen, but the action we've seen in IPOs, particularly the high-profile ones that launched in March, has been pretty rational to me. I'm not going to sit here and say whether or not Lyft is fairly priced or, Tradeweb is fairly priced right now, but we haven't seen, real craziness ensue. Yeah, there was a bunch of headlines about was Lyft going to go up or down, but it's not like it, plummeted to bankruptcy levels, and it didn't soar 200%. So I think this is a fairly healthy market for the IPO space right now. I wouldn't be cautious just because you think the market's a little toppy.
We'll wait and see what happens with a Peloton IPO. If that thing lights the world on fire, then perhaps we have run a bit too far in the markets. Dave, always appreciate you joining us. Look forward to chatting again next week.
Yep, talk to you next week.
That was ETF.com's Dave Nottig. Let's take a break, and when we come back, we'll be joined by Phil Huber, Chief Investment Officer at Huber Financial Advisors. We're going to cover a bunch of topics. We'll talk about their ETF selection process, and then we're going to run Phil through our rapid-fire ETF Q&A. We'll do that right after the break. You're listening to ETF Prime. Welcome back to ETF Prime. Nate Geraci alongside Jason Lank. And we now have joining us via phone from Chicago, Phil Huber, Chief Investment Officer at Huber Financial Advisors. Phil also has a great blog at bipsandpieces.com. Phil, thanks for joining us today.
Thanks for having me, Nate. Appreciate to have me on.
All right, Phil. So just to clarify for everyone, what is the proper pronunciation for the basis points abbreviation? I saw you going back and forth on Twitter on this.
Yeah, I didn't even realize that was a debate.
Me neither.
It's BIPS. Some people, I guess, go beeps. Some others might spell out the BPS, but yeah, it's always BIPS to me.
All right, you and I are on the same page, and it's scary to think who is using beeps and BPS. All right, so first, some quick backstory. You and I met at the Inside ETFs conference earlier this year, and we got to talking. Your firm uses ETFs. And I always think it's interesting to learn how different firms approach the ETF space. We actually had an ETF strategist on the podcast a few weeks ago. Maybe first start by telling us a little bit about Huber Financial Advisors, and then give us some background on your use of ETFs.
Sure. So we've been in business for just over 30 years now, and we do financial planning and investment management, and so our portfolio construction, the way we manage money for clients, is to design and build multi-asset allocation strategies that are tailored to a client's financial plan. And so we're a bit product agnostic in that sense. We don't do any in-house money management. We're not stock pickers or bond pickers, so we do use all 40 Act type products, but we use mutual funds in certain areas, ETFs in others, and interval funds in other cases. So, it really just depends on the type of exposure we're trying to get. But in that sense, ETFs have certainly grown in terms of our usage of them over the years, but we still use a fair amount of mutual funds as well.
All right, so when you're looking into your portfolios, how do you decide, A, whether an ETF is the right investment vehicle to execute whatever it is you're trying to do? And then B, if it is, how do you determine which ETFs to use?
Sure. So I would say the areas might be easier actually to start where we don't use ETFs. So I think the quality of certain types of liquid alternative strategies is better in the mutual fund structure. And so we tend to not really use any ETFs in that bucket of the portfolio. And then we actually, you know, in terms of the active kind of passive debate, while we're more skewed towards kind of passive and factor-based investments on the equity side, we tend to err more towards active managers on the bond side. And so while we do use a couple of bond ETFs for certain portfolios or models, we use, you know, largely institutional active management in that space. And so our primary usage of ETFs tends to be within different parts of the equity universe. From a selection standpoint, it's really, in some cases, you know, kind of broad beta type exposures, but generally speaking, more factor-oriented strategies.
Yeah, so on the factor-based ETFs, and we're talking momentum, value, dividend growth, those sorts of things, how do you approach this space? Because there's a lot of product out there. As you know, there's a spectrum in terms of how much factor exposure these ETFs provide. So what does your decision-making process look like around these?
Sure, yeah. So first of all, there's so many decision points that go into this, where I think a lot of people don't quite look as deep under the hood of different products, because it might just be, oh, I like this fund provider and it has, you know, factor in the name, so that's good enough for me, and off we go. But, you know, I did a blog post on this a couple of months ago. If you take a look at the landscape of just we'll focus on multi-factor products for now. You know, there's at least a dozen multi-factor funds out there from all the different providers. If you expand that to include mutual funds, there's a handful of other kind of quantitative, you know, quasi-active strategies there. So if you look across that spectrum, you'll see that all of them have, you know, a different set of factors that they blend together. Some of them do large cap stocks only, some do large, mid, small. You know, fees are, there's quite a large range in fees. Some are a little more dynamic in how they manage factor exposures. Others are a bit more, you know, consistent or strategic in nature. And then it gets the tracking error too. Some, you know, hug pretty close to the benchmark, whereas others have a bit higher tracking error and active share. So plenty of things. It really just boils down to what are you trying to achieve as an investor? What are the factors that you truly believe in? And trying to find the product that best aligns with, you know, how you wish to invest.
You mentioned tracking error. One thing I'm curious about, look, your firm manages nearly $1.5 billion. You have a lot on the line with your end clients. So when you're looking at factor exposure, how do you decide how concentrated or pure the exposure will be? And probably more importantly, how do you prepare end clients for that ride? Because as you know, if you invest in, let's say, a pure concentrated value ETF, there's going to be extremely high tracking error. So what are you looking for here?
Right. I think that A gives merit to the idea of using multiple factors as opposed to one. If you're only investing in, say, the value factor, that's going to obviously give you much higher tracking error to something like the S&P. You know, I think if you're going to make the active decision to be a factor investor, you have to know going in that you have to be different than the index. And if that's not something that someone's comfortable with, then you're much better off in a beta-focused portfolio. But I think you have to be able to tolerate a healthy amount of tracking error in order to try to maximize your odds of success as a factor investor. But that also requires that, you know what's going on under the hood of the funds you own, and it requires patience and a long-term horizon, because any factor, you know, value being the case most recently, can go through a fairly significant period of underperformance. So you have to be prepared for that. At the end of the day, these are active strategies. It's a lot different than, you know, the traditional type of active management where you're hiring someone to kind of, you know, pick stocks for you on a discretionary basis, but it's still active. And so you have to be prepared for the, you know, the outcomes, good or bad.
You mentioned on the fixed income side of your portfolios, you are more likely to use actively managed strategies. And look, as a whole, I think the active versus passive debate has grown extremely tired, right? I think pretty much anything you do in an investment portfolio, there's an active element to it. But, you know, if you look at all the data, and we can debate the data, passive, you know, tends to outperform, or you could say active tends to underperform passive over the long term. So what has you looking at active strategies on the bond side of the equation?
Well, I think first and foremost, the evidence isn't quite as compelling against active management as it is with equities. I think once you do some just initial screens for, like, we only use institutional share classes, so that screen alone off the bat, I think, improves your odds of success. We use a handful of managers, too. We're not betting everything on one, you know, intermediate core manager, so I think you get some manager diversification as well. But at the end of the day, it's not a guarantee. We think there's flaws in the way that traditional bond indexes are constructed. So there's a number of reasons that go into it. There's a large presence of non-economic participants in bond markets that might not be motivated purely by profit maximization. And so a lot of different factors. There's been some good research put out by PIMCO and Guggenheim and a few others just on this idea of why bonds are a bit different than stocks in terms of the active-passive debate. But, you know, I think there's certainly – you're starting to see some – sparks of innovation in ETFs with kind of more systematic approaches to fixed income, trying to do kind of what's been done in equities over the past, you know, 5-10 years. But, you know, I think the jury's still out in that sense.
You mentioned innovation in ETFs. Any thoughts on new ETFs? Because there's a lot of debate in the ETF industry right now about whether there are barriers to new ETFs getting off the ground. So I'm just curious, as you look at your ETF due diligence process, do you have AUM screens, liquidity screens, anything else? How do you approach new ETFs?
Sure. I there's no hard and fast numbers that we have. But that being said, you know, we're not going to probably jump right into a brand new ETF that's got, you know, $5 million in it. Just given the type of business we have, and, you know, we're always managing cash flow, so we need to be able to kind of trade and, you know, operate and manage our portfolios, you know, relatively efficiently. And so it would be pretty rare for us to just kind of be a kind of seed investor or kind of day one investor in a new ETF. So we would like to see some level of traction, but, you know, it doesn't have to be a $1 billion fund for us to participate. We just want to make sure that we can, you know, effectively trade it and and then that it fits with what we're trying to do inside the portfolio.
Phil, this is Jason Lank. On that subject of the size of an ETF, really scale, your firm has enjoyed a lot of success. Is there any difference in the way you approach ETF selection or investment selection when you manage $500 million versus $1.5 billion? Does your process change at all?
It's hard to say because, you know, I would say the growth of ETFs in our portfolios is really largely taken place in the past, you know, call it 3 to 5 years. And so when we were $500 million in assets under management, it was still almost exclusively mutual fund-based. So it's hard to say. I would imagine not now a great deal would be different. You know, at the end of the day, the types of ETFs we're selecting are not the very narrow, niche-y type of products to begin with. And so generally speaking, you know, the size or liquidity of the ETFs that are kind of in our universe, it's generally not a huge concern to us because they tend to be, you know, of decent enough size.
Phil, obviously ETF fees continue making a lot of headlines. What role does cost play in your selection process? And I guess along with that, commission-free ETFs?
Sure. So I guess I'll tackle the free side in terms of expense ratio first. I think investors should always be wary of anything that's being offered is free. You know, if the product is free, then you're the product. I think the shift that we've seen from like 1% plus in just getting large cap, you know, U.S. stock exposure down to, you know, 20 basis points, that was the big deal. I think this haggling over 1 or 2 basis points and the kind of fee wars you're seeing where, you know, the different beta providers are putting out ads in Barron's and elsewhere about, well, we now have the cheapest large cap equity ETF at 4 basis points and now it's 3 basis points. It's at the end of the day, you're kind of splitting hairs when it gets down to that, when you're just fighting over 1 or 2 basis points. And there's, you know, at the end of the day, obviously, all else equal, cheaper is better, but all else is rarely equal. An analogy I was thinking of was, you know, if somebody offered to babysit your kids for free, you probably wouldn't just respond with, when can you start?
Right.
You want to do a little bit more due diligence.
Yeah.
Probably some, you know, background checks and references and things like that. So, I think, you know, it might be a bit gimmicky, the whole, we're offering this ETF for free. That being said, the commission-free ETF side of things, as a operator and someone who's trying to, you know, manage portfolios for, you know, call it roughly 1,000 households that have continual deposits and withdrawals, having access to a broad menu of, you know, commission-free trading ETFs there's value to that for us, just operationally. So I think that's a plus. I mean, at the end of the day, even if ETFs aren't commission free, they're, you know, we use Schwab as our custodian. It's $4.95 a trade. It's relative to 10, 20 years ago, that's extremely cheap to trade, whether it's commission or commission free on the trade. But, you know, it certainly kind of smooths out things a little bit, having those commission free options. And certainly Schwab, expanded their platform a great deal earlier this year from 200 something, you know, commission-free ETFs to over 500. But that being said, you don't have to be commission-free to be a part of our lineup.
Our guest is Phil Huber, Chief Investment Officer at Huber Financial Advisors. All right, Phil, with the remaining time we have, I have to put you through our rapid-fire Q&A. We've got about 5 minutes here, so hopefully we can have some fun with these. I tend to keep these ETF-focused, but I'm going to toss in a couple of more general investing questions for you as well. So if you're ready, I'm just going to start firing away here.
Yeah, fire away. This should be fun.
Okay, so first, my standard question that everyone gets, should a Bitcoin ETF exist? And if it did, would you consider it for a portfolio?
So it's hard for me to say an ETF should or shouldn't exist. There's probably plenty of ETFs that already exist that, in my mind, you know, there's really not a need for. But, you know, that's the beauty of ETFs. Anyone's free to launch one. And as a consumer, you don't have to buy them if you don't like them. So I think it's an inevitability that there will be a Bitcoin ETF eventually. As to whether we would buy it for clients, I would say it's highly unlikely. But, you know, never say never.
Fair enough. All right. Another standard question, your favorite ETF ticker symbol. And by the way, I have to mention, a while back, Tadas Viscanta asked several people, including you, what ETF, if it were launched tomorrow, would you invest in? And I got a huge kick out of this. You responded with the inverse Gartman ETF. This was obviously tongue in cheek, but the ticker symbol you proposed was fantastic. It was wrong. WRNG. I just love that. So what is your favorite ticker symbol for an ETF that currently exists?
Oh, man. So I gave way more thought to this question than I probably should have. So I think there's two camps of great ETF tickers. I think there's the, call it, more gimmicky tickers, the Moo and the other ones like that, where it's kind of a word that's, you know, associated with the fund itself, and it's kind of fun to say. But then I think there's another camp where, you know, so I'll give an example, like something like QVAL from Alpha Architect. It's one of those ones, got two syllables, it kind of tells you a little bit about the strategy, quantitative value, and it just rolls off the tongue nicely. Like, it's just, you know, easy to say. I think the tougher tickers are the ones that you have to spell out completely, like, say, like GLD, like you got to say GLD. I like, you know, QVAL, you're just like QVAL. Another one like in that vein would be Aggie from WisdomTree. It's the yield enhanced aggregate bond ETF. It's just kind of a fun one to say, Aggie. But I think if I had to pick one as the greatest ticker of all time, I would have to go with GOAT from VanEck. They had their Moat suite of ETFs, which obviously Moat itself is a great ticker for the U.S. one, but then they came out with the global Moat, I think it was last year, and that's got the ticker GOAT, so that might be my favorite.
I agree. I like that one from last year. I've mentioned this before. My favorite ticker symbol is still Moo, so I'm waiting for somebody to beat that. Though we saw the UFO ETF launch recently, so that's pretty good as well.
Yeah, that's pretty fun.
So next question, and you already touched on this quite a bit, but I'll still ask you. So back in March, Salt Financial filed for the first negative fee ETF, and at the time, you tweeted, quote, still holding out for the ETF that will pay me in cash, preferably non-sequential unmarked bills, neatly packaged in a large duffel bag, and drop it in undisclosed location of my choosing. I don't know how you come up with this stuff, but Negative fee ETF, gimmick or good for investors?
I think gimmick, but then ask me again if someone's offering to pay me 1% to hold their ETF, then maybe I'll listen.
All right, on a bit of a more serious note, in your opinion, what is the single most important factor to long-term investing success?
This is going to sound probably cliche, and I'm sure it's an answer you've gotten before, but I think at the end of the day, the biggest factor is the one that stares us in the mirror every day. It's our own behavior. So as an investment advisor, I look at our job as twofold. I think it's, I don't want to downplay the importance of, choosing great investments and building great portfolios, but I think it's also equally, if not more important, that we spend time trying to cultivate great investors. And that comes through just regular communication and education efforts with your clients, taking the news and different events that are happening each day that might frighten clients and derail their plans and their portfolios, and trying to use history, set expectations, provide context, all those things. You want to make sure your clients really understand what you're doing and why you're doing it when it comes to managing their money, and not just sort of assume that they understand what it is. You can't be transparent enough or communicate enough with clients, is my opinion. So that's a big reason why I do the blog or I'm active on social media, is to help just spread our philosophy, spread our thoughts and opinions on different investment related topics.
I love that answer. I mean, it really boils down to behavior and education, and the education piece helps the behavior. All right, last question. There's been a lot of discussion recently around advisor fees. So we saw Schwab's robo CFP service come out with a subscription-based model a few weeks ago. Do you have any strong opinions on what the right fee model is, or at least how investors should think about advisor fees?
It kind of reminds me of that quote, democracy is the worst form of government, except for all the others. I think, so we charge AUM-based fees for our clients, and those scale down as assets grow, so it's a tiered fee schedule. So I love seeing innovation in terms of how, advisors are thinking about charging for their services, and I don't think there's a perfect fee model out there. People, will point out the flaws in AUM-based fees, but I think there's, you can always pick apart or find some kind of flaw in any type of fee arrangement. I think at the end of the day, we're confident that in the quality of the work we do and the value we're providing is well in excess of the fees that we charge clients. I think when I look at the skill and the expertise and the care that our team exercises with clients every day, the breadth of our service offerings, above and beyond just, managing a portfolio, I'm very, very confident that we're just giving an experience to clients that they can't get off the shelf at a discounted rate, whether that be in an AUM, a cheaper AUM model, or some other subscription-based or, kind of retainer-type model. So, I don't want to come across as dogmatic in my thinking of, AUM-based fees. We're always open to, exploring new ideas and keeping an open mind. But to date, nothing's been compelling enough for us to feel like we need to, warrant shifting how we charge our fees.
Well, Phil, we'll have to leave it there. This was a lot of fun. We'll certainly have to do this again. Thank you for joining us today.
Thanks so much, Nate. I really appreciate it. This was fun.
That was Phil Huber, Chief Investment Officer at Huber Financial Advisors. And I should mention, Phil is a great follow on Twitter. He's at Bips and Pieces. That's BPS and Pieces. Let's take a break. And when we come back, we'll spotlight the brand new Hoya Capital Housing ETF. We'll be joined by the president of Hoya Capital, Alex Petty. This is ETF Prime. Welcome back to ETF Prime. Let's go right to our ETF Spotlight.
It's time for the ETF Spotlight, where each week we highlight one exchange-traded fund. There are thousands of ETFs available to invest in. ETF Prime has sorted through them all, so you don't have to.
The ETF we're spotlighting this week is the Hoya Capital Housing ETF. Great ticker symbol, HOMZ, H-O-M-Z. This just launched a few weeks ago, and joining us via phone from Connecticut to discuss this ETF is Alex Petty, president and head of ETFs for Hoya Capital Real Estate. Alex, thanks for joining us today.
Hey, guys.
So, Alex, before we get into the ETF, tell us a little bit about your background and what Hoya Capital does.
Sure. So we started Hoya Capital in 2015. It kind of informally actually started in about 2013. And we've been kind of very active in doing, we're a research-driven investment advisory. And so kind of the core of our research is on REITs, on housing. And so we actually publish kind of these quarterly REIT sectors. We publish kind of a weekly housing data thing. So homes is kind of our first major kind of launch, and we launched it last March 20th. So.
Well, okay, so let's talk more about that, the Hoya Capital Housing ETF. This is being called the first ETF to offer diversified exposure across the entire U.S. housing sector. Explain what that means and what this ETF does.
Right. So, there's currently ETFs that do invest in housing. So there's the home builder ETF. So, you know, there's XHB, there's ITB, and then there's the REIT ETF. So there's VNQ. There's a REIT that called RES that's kind of more specific to the housing segment. But it's crazy that there's been no ETF that sees the housing market as kind of a single sector. And I think that's it's kind of partially the effects of kind of the sector classification. So there's GIC sectors. I think kind of the big index providers don't really want to stray too far from the kind of classic kind of sector lines. And so it kind of took a smaller index provider to rewrite the kind of index rules kind of, and kind of see housing as kind of a single sector.
So tell us more about that index. So what exactly is included here? If you look under the hood, look at the holdings.
Right. So it's the entire housing market. And so we kind of set out to define what the parameters of the housing market were. And this process started 3 or 4 years ago. And it's actually a pretty long, challenging process, because you first need to define, well, what is the housing index for the housing industry? And then then part two is kind of finding the companies that actually represent that exposure. And so we looked at data and kind of split it into kind of four major categories. And so the index includes essentially the 100 names that kind of reflect the U.S. housing market. And so the two major categories are the home ownership and rental categories. So that's about 30% of the index. That's about it's mostly REITs. It's I think about 20 REITs. The other major category is the home building and construction category. So that's the home builders, that's the home building products. There's also some timber REITs in there. That's another 30% of the index there. Home improvement is about 20% of the index. That includes names like Home Depot, like Lowe's, home furnishing companies, home appliance companies. And then the last category is the home financing technology and services category. So this includes names like Zillow, Redfin, also home financing companies. So it has the 6 or 7 largest mortgage banks in the U.S. And really, what the goal was to kind of have the index reflect a kind of diversified view of the entire U.S. housing industry. And so by kind of taking this diversified view, it's kind of exhibited kind of less volatility and kind of less interest rate as the kind of major kind of subsector ETFs, which are the kind of REIT and then the home builder ETFs.
Alex, I'm curious, what was the backstory on launching this ETF? What was the impetus to take the leap here?
Right. So it's really kind of rooted in our research. So our kind of research focuses on this kind of lingering housing shortage and kind of the effects of this lingering underinvestment in housing, which has really been pretty significant since 2008. But really, you can actually trace this lingering housing shortage actually all the way back to about the mid-1990s. And there's been a pretty significant underinvestment in new home construction. There's also been an underinvestment in existing homes. And so this underinvestment kind of has very far-reaching effects in that existing homes are now older. Older homes require more, new water heaters, new cabinets. But then also the kind of central effect is that the housing shortage, the housing underinvestment, is causing this lingering rise in housing costs and rents. And so it really was kind of at its core, it was designed to kind of give especially renters this kind of opportunity to kind of get their foot in the door of the housing market with what we think at the ETF level is as close as you can get to kind of a physical investment in housing.
And Alex, can you talk more about the role of owning real estate exposure in a portfolio just at a broader level?
Right. So I think that the aspects you get with real estate are not correlated with or less correlated to stocks. It's kind of in between stocks and bonds. And so it kind of gives you that diversification, that income and growth balance that's kind of well suited for pretty much any portfolio, but it's kind of that balance in between stocks and bonds.
You mentioned this ETF could perhaps be a fit for somebody who doesn't currently own a home, and you talked about how home ownership has been pushed out of reach for a lot of people. But for people who do own a home, there's always this debate over whether they should, double down on this type of exposure in their investment portfolio. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Right. So I think our kind of pitch to the existing owners is that so your investment in a home is one investment on one block and in one neighborhood. It's not very diversified. And so, homes kind of gives existing homeowners that kind of diversification, that exposure, so that they're not so dependent on the kind of idiosyncratic risks of a single property in a single area. And so the ETF actually has exposure to, I think it's like 1.2 million rental units. It tracks companies that had built about 250,000 homes. And so it really is kind of the way to diversify any sort of housing-related exposures.
Alex, we have about 2 minutes left. Any high-level thoughts on the current housing market? Anything noteworthy you're seeing right now?
Right. So I think that there was certainly a slowdown last year, and it was very rate-driven. And kind of our research indicates that 2018 looks a lot like 2014 and 2015, where rates suddenly surged in 2014, and it significantly slowed the housing markets. But they quickly kind of as rates pulled back in 2015, started to reaccelerate home sales. Grew, and so I think that you're kind of seeing a very similar effect now, in that as rates have pulled back, that you're starting to see more optimism in the housing markets as a whole.
What about demographics moving forward? You hear about particularly millennials. You mentioned the rentals, but moving out of the rental market and starting to form households. Is that something you're seeing in terms of the demographics?
Right. So the largest kind of four-year mini generation in the U.S. is actually between 26 and 30 now. And so that kind of age is kind of prime kind of household years. So yes, like the next decade, we're we're kind of very bullish on new household growth.
Well, Alex, we'll have to leave it there. We are out of time. Congratulations on the launch. We wish you all the success. Thank you for joining
us
today.
Thank you.
That was Alex Petty, president and head of ETFs for Hoya Capital Real Estate. Again, the ETF is the Hoya Capital Housing ETF, ticker HOMZ. And you can learn more about this ETF by visiting thehousingetf.com. Again, what's unique about this is that it is offering diversified exposure to the housing sector. You have REITs focused on rentals. You have home construction companies, home improvement and furnishing companies. And then he mentioned real estate technology services. So certainly an interesting option in the real estate space. That'll do it for today's show. I want to thank our exclusive sponsor, Legg Mason. You can visit leggmason.com to learn more about their broad range of investment strategies. Podcasts of ETF Prime are available at etfprime.com, etf.com, iTunes, and Spotify. You can follow me on Twitter, at Nate Geraci. Next week, we'll be joined by CFRA's Todd Rosenbluth. We'll discuss some of the latest ETF trends. And then Michael DePalma, CEO and Senior Portfolio Manager at Phase Capital, will spotlight the high-yield ETF. Until then, have a great week, everyone.